Moving to carbon experiments. The plan is to, I'm going to give a very short overview of what we have to optimize when we want to do CP. This again will be quite a lot of repetition with what Sami presented. So we will see these parameters and then we will optimize them one by one. Then we will launch a multi-CP experiment where we hope to reach tens of percents of carbon polarization. And after that, we'll have a hyperpolarized carbon signal, and we will use this high signal to measure the angle with the small angle decay that Sami mentioned. And probably while we are in the afternoon, we are preparing the, we are analyzing the data with MATLAB. We can launch a thermal equilibrium for the carbon and quantify the polarization of the carbon spins. This is the experiments that we are going to use once more. So we start with saturating the spins, usually. We switch on microwave and detection on the carbon spins. Then when we want to do a CP, we always gate the microwaves. And we have these two pulses to put the proton and carbon magnetization in a transverse plane, the spin locks during which the transfer of polarization occurs. And then what is a little unusual, sometimes you see this pulse, but not this one in most standard MAS experiments. We put back both spins along Z because we want to store the polarization and keep building in. And once we get to this point, we go back here and loop this whole thing. Polarize the proton, transfer to carbon, polarize the proton, transfer to carbon. So we'll have all the powers on these pulses to optimize. So we want to optimize them. first here, we should use 90 degree pulses, so it could be squares. For some reason, we use something that is really weird. It's a inversion pulse cut in two. So we use the first half of an inversion pulse. And it works better. I have really not much explanation that it works better. But you can just think of it as a square pulse. Sammy, you want to
say inversion pulse? What's the name of the pulse? What's the shape of the pulse?
It's a chirp, no?
Yes, it's a
chirp
pulse.
Yeah, chirp pulse cut into. So we want to optimize the different powers, and so we have the, when I say the 90 degree, I'm talking about this half chirp, but its aim is to do 90 degree pulse. And we want to find the minimum power where it is efficient. It's not like when you do a hard pulse. With a hard pulse, there's an optimal power, it's not a minimum power. With this type of pulses, there's a minimum power where the pulse is efficient. So we will find this one. Then we will find the minimum power of spin lock. So spin lock is this pulse. The minimum we need to apply for the protons to be sustained. Same thing with the carbon. We need to find the minimum power here for it to be efficient. And finally, the power on the spin lock. So this pulse, we are not searching for a minimum, but really an optimum, because we need to be in the Hartmann-Hahn condition. The nutation on the proton and the carbon needs to be the same. So when we fix this power, the spin lock when we fix the spin lock power on the proton, the spin lock power on the carbon needs to match. It's not just a minimum. Then we'll optimize the spin lock time and finally the gating time if we have enough time. So the spin lock time is the duration here, and the gating time is how long we wait between switching off the microwave and doing the CP. Oh yeah, you're right. So when we will optimize the proton pulses, it's on a pulse sequence where we only look at the proton, you will see. 11 and 12 are always the name that we put on the channel that we are observing. Once we will be looking at the proton, the carbon, there will still be the proton pulses, but 11 will become 21 and 12 will become 22. But I will say it again. It's a bit, can be a bit confusing. It's just for us more convenient to have every time the channel where we observe to have consistent names. So I'm going to copy one of these experiments. So I copy an experiment that I did yesterday for the CP optimization. And the parameters I choose for the microwave, they were for negative DNP. We can do negative or positive. It doesn't change anything for the optimization of the CP. I just want to say a final thing is that when we do this, when you want to do a multi-CP to reach high carbon polarization, this delay here will be minutes or tens of seconds. So you polarize the proton spin really well and then you transfer to carbon. When we want to optimize one of these parameters, we will choose 1 second. So it means we saturate the spins, we start from zero, we do 1 second of DNP, and at this point here, we have a consistent proton polarization that we can use to optimize the CP. Let's have a look at the refill. So what you can see here is that the refill is finished. The sensors are in liquid helium, but putting helium at 4 Kelvin, now the cryostat has increased its temperature and is going down. Now it's at 1.8 Kelvin, so we can soon start experiments. It will soon be stable. If I do my optimization now, it's not great because the temperature is decreasing. So as I'm varying one parameter, temperature decreases, so polarization increases. It's a very slight bias, but between 1.6 and 1.7 Kelvin, it shouldn't be dramatic. So I want to show you how this pulse sequence works. We again make use of options here. So I have different options. It's written here. Option one, it's no CP pulses. So it means that if I choose this option, where's top spin? Yeah. I go here in the parameters and I will choose option one. When I look at the graphical edit, I have saturation DNP detection. I did nothing. So this is an experiment just to have a reference signal for the proton. Even though we are not exactly at, the temperature is not completely stable, let's do the reference experiment like this. It's not a big deal. We also have other options here. This one means that we start by saturating the spins. This one means that we are doing some DNP. And this one says that we are going to gate the microwaves before we do anything. Here we do nothing, so we gate, but nothing happens afterwards. So I do this experiment. My keyboard is not matching what happens here. It's not convenient. Okay, EFP. Again, it's negative because I copied from an experiment that was phased with positive DNP. So I want to change the phase here. So this is, there's not much to say here. It's just our reference signal. And now we want to optimize the power on the spin lock pulses, PLW11. And to do this, we go in the parameters here. And we use option two. Why option two? Let's have a look. If I open the pulse sequence. Oops. Yeah, I need to reopen it. Graphical edits. Yeah. So now that I have put option two, it introduces the 90 degree pulses. So it means that I have a 90 degree pulses that bring the spins in the plane and then immediately after bring them back along Z. and I will see what minimum power I'll need to for the spins to go back. To do this, I do a popped parameter optimization, and the power on this pulse is PLW11. I will go from 0 to 40 watts with increments of 5. Each experiment takes 1 second, so it's really not long. So now it means that I'm repeating the same experiment, increasing the power on the spin lock. The first one is with zero power. So it is equivalent to our reference experiment. We have polarized the spin, done nothing, and detected. And the second one, we polarize the spin, do a very weak, inefficient pulse that will just mess up everything and go back. And as it increases, we coherently bring the spins and back. So let's have a look. And it looks like we have created polarization, because that's a little weird. What we see here is that by bringing the spin in the plane and back, we have more signal than doing nothing, which is, I will not try to explain, understand why this happens. There are weird things that happen during these pulses. But what we wanted to know is how much power we need to be at saturation. So here we can choose like 25 watts. That seems to be enough to move the spins. So I choose PLW11 is equal to 25 watts. For the record, to be able to look at it later on, this reference experiment, I will save it in PROC 2. And I will repeat the experiments with the parameters that we have chosen. Now I can compare. It doesn't make much sense. In fact, there's something I did not say. It's because I did negative DNP to 80% polarization before, and then I did my reference experiment immediately after. I'm doing my reference experiment with spins that remember a huge polarization of before. So my reference is a super bad reference. Maybe I can redo the reference. I think I should do that. So to do this, I change the options again. This may be a little confusing. I save it in 2, go back to the options, and now put our 90-degree pulses. So they overlap, which is very nice. It means that by putting the spins from Z to X and back to Z, we don't lose anything. It's working well. Now we are going to use option 3 to optimize the power on the spin lock pulse. With option 3, I get confused between my screens. Yeah. Option 3, in addition to the 90 degree pulse in and out, in between we have the spin lock. And in between the pulse and the spin lock, we need some time just to change the power. And you see here that this time is 100 nanoseconds. It needs to be super short because your spins, they are alone in the plane. So they're going to dephase very rapidly. So you want to switch the power very rapidly before locking them. So again, I'm going to do a parameter optimization, but this time on PLW 12, and I can keep the same range, it's fine.
How long is the spin lock?
It's a good question. I think it is 2 millia. Doesn't want to tell me. 3 milli. It's the spin lock we choose It can be 3 milli, 4 milli, 6 milli, it's not a big deal, it just needs to be constant. We will optimize later, but for optimizing the power, it just needs to be constant. So this time, when we put no power, we are not going to see the maximum signal, because it means when we put no power, it means that we do a 90 degree pulse, wait 3 milliseconds, and do a 90 degree pulse back, so there's nothing left. And we see here that with 20 watts, this is a bit generous, with 20 watts, we have a very good spin lock. Here, as I said before, I search for a minimum, but this has implication for the power I will have to put on the carbon afterwards. So if I say, oh, let's put 40 watts, it means that I would have to put a lot of power on the carbons as well. So I prefer not to go too high, and we'll see what happens with the carbon. So I choose 20 watts for now. So PLW12 set to 20 watts. This experiment that you see here was the one with just chirp in, chirp back. I will save it in 3. And now I repeat experiment 1. Experiment 2 is a reference experiment. Experiment 3 is the 90 degree in, 90 degree out experiment. And the one I will save in 4, WRP4. This one is the chirp in, spin lock, chirp back. And I'm a little confused because when I overlaid the blue and the red before, they were completely overlapping. So yeah, but yeah. Okay. So now we have even more signals, so I'm even more confused. But yeah. Things happen. Maybe you have an explanation, Sami?
So the one is the one you just did. The blue one, the one that has less signal. It's really,
I got confused myself with the numbers. You're right. So it makes sense. We lose signal as we do more pulses. Thank you, Sami. So now I can move to carbon experiments. So I will copy this experiment and I will load a set of parameters that we typically use. So it's where is it? This one. So it's called OptiCP13C. So if I load this set of parameters, apart from the title, I load all the parameters. This will be useful just to start with sensible parameters, and I will put in the parameters that I've optimized for proton spins. And now we are using two channels, one for the proton, one for the carbon, but we detect only the carbon. So it is super important to set the carrier frequency of the protons well. Because if you say it's wrong, it's not that you're going to see that you are off resonance, because you don't look at this channel. So we are going to be very careful. We go back here, where I should have explained this long ago. Here we have an O1 of minus 13 kilohertz, and we always put the SR minus to 13 kilohertz. SR is just a display shift on the x-axis. Our use is always to have them the same, so that it means that the carrier is on zero. So it means anytime we see the signal is not on zero, it means that the signal is not aligned with the carrier. It's very convenient to see make sure that you are on resonance. So we'll copy this O1, go to my carbon experiment, just gonna refresh the tree here. So I go to my carbon experiment, and it doesn't go in O1. The O1 of the proton goes to the O2 of this experiment, not the O1, because in this experiment the carbon is the second channel. Yes.
This O2, Are you optimizing also this one?
No, we assume that it just needs to be on resonance. It is always true, except in weird cases. For example, if you use label formate, you have a dipolar coupling between the proton and the carbon that is immense, and then it starts to be not so clear where you should irradiate. So here you can optimize, but what happens is a little complicated to interpret. So here, a lot is wrong. So I have to put the right. This I did not show the mutation curve for the proton and carbon, but it was 525 the pulse length for the proton, 60 watt is what we use for our reference power. We chose 30 watts for the PL. I don't remember what was the 20 watts of the spin lock. And the chirp, I think it was 30. No, I can go back here. Here it was PLW 11, 25 watts. In this one, PLW 11 becomes PLW 21 because it's the second channel now. 25 watts. Carbon, I don't need to change. I'm just gonna check also the pulse lengths. It's 9.5 microseconds, the pulse lengths for the carbon, both for saturation pulses and detection pulses. What else? Yeah, that's more or less everything we need to know. We have these powers here are the saturation detection, spin lock, chirp, or 90 degree pulses for the CP on carbon, and spin lock on carbon. They are not optimized yet. So I'm just going to do one reference experiment, and we are going to see if the O1 of the carbon is correct. I phase. It's not a big shift, but I can still correct. So let's just make sure that O1 is equal to SR. It's 8K in both cases. And if I want to correct here, this is at 3.8 kilohertz. So the way I always do it is I open the SR, I add 3.8 kilohertz, copy this. Now I put the same value in O1. And if I repeat the experiment, I should have the signal centered on O1 if I did not do any mistake. So if it's not clear, interrupt me. Phase has changed, okay. The signal is a bit weird, and if we use small angle pulses instead of 90 degree pulses, it's usually cleaner. I don't really know the details why, but
Just
one very short D1. Yeah. At least it's not a nice shape. It's enough to optimize the parameters. So in this case, I will open the pulse sequence. In this case, we cannot do as we did before, where we don't put all the pulses, because we need to transfer the polarization from the proton to the carbon all the time. So we have the full CP sequence now with both 90 degree pulses on proton and carbon, spin lock, and then 90 degree back. And we end up with a detection here. And I'm going to optimize the power on the 90 degree pulses first, and then the power on the spin lock for the carbon, PLW 11 and 12. By the way, now it is a moment where it is really important that I make sure I'm in liquid helium all the time I do an experiment, because we use high power pulses. And if I use high power pulses in the gas, I will surely make arcing. And this is not, in the best case, it will only mess up my experiment. In the worst case, it would damage a capacitor, and then we have to take the probe out and repair it, which takes usually, if you are super fast, a few hours. And then you put the probe back in the liquid helium and you break another capacitor, so it takes another day. So you prefer not to break capacitors. So I will optimize, as I said, PLW11. This time we go to much higher powers. On carbon, we need higher powers. We go in steps of 10. Can you tell me what you expect with zero power? What's the shape of the curve we expect here?
The power of the spin lock or what?
Power of the spin lock on the carbon. With zero? Yeah, and then it starts from zero, and where does it go? Does it go to a maximum and it decays? Does it go up monotonically?
It will go up and down.
I think it will just go up.
Because in principle, if you go up, like when the mutation frequency of the carbon will be higher eventually, right?
You are thinking of the spin lock, I think.
Huh?
You are thinking of the spin lock.
Right.
This is a...
This is
excitation pulse. And it's an excitation pulse, it's an adiabatic pulse, so you need to put a minimum power to... And the pattern that we see here is, I'm not surprised to see it, not because it makes sense, but because we saw the same on Tuesday. I couldn't explain it on Tuesday and I cannot explain it now. So it's like there's this sort of bump. No clue where it comes from. But we have an adiabatic pulse. The more power we put, the better the excitation. So we can probably put the maximum power 100. Yeah? Kirill?
Okay, so actually now I'm looking at this pulse sequence. Why do we actually need this 90-degree adiabatic pulses on carbon?
Instead of...
there is no magnetization on carbon, let's say.
You are completely right. It's just that we have the same CP block that we will use later. You know, then later when we do multi-CP, we always need to put the previous polarization in the plane, make it evolve and go back. But here we don't need it. It's just that we have the same block and we copy-paste from sequence to sequence. Here I'm tempted to take the maximum power because it's a short pulse. Short pulse, it's 175 microseconds. On the spin lock, it's milliseconds, so I'm usually more conservative.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
You also have the feedback pulse on the proton.
Yeah.
Which is quite high power.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you hit the second matching condition, which is the transfer of polarization during the feedback.
Nice.
So if you remove the proton feedback pulse, you maybe will reach a better plateau.
So instead of removing, because I would have to change the code, I prefer to do this. I change the power on the proton. I think I have to go back to the number one. I will change the power on the, put 15 watts instead of 25 on the proton, and then repeat the optimization. It's very interesting. So we do a CP, we transfer polarization during the spin lock. But what happens during the excitation pulses also matters.
But you have no spin lock.
I do.
Yeah, but then you have two power. You're just optimizing the spin lock power.
I'm optimizing the power on the chirp, on the 90 degree in and 90 degree out, both of them at the same
time.
On the carbon. And now it seems much more well behaved. So it means that we are probably not really doing a transfer. Oh, we'll see. I say it's well behaved, but it's probably not. It's not something that we have investigated systematically. Does the transfer occur a lot during the 90-degree pulses Or maybe Stuart did?
No, but at the beginning we used to just do an inversion loss. Mm-hmm. So we didn't have the spin lock because the spectrometer had a dead time that was too long. We had the DRX also at the beginning. It was working pretty well. Mm-hmm. So you could just do some chirp pulse, synchronize and transfer polarization. And then we realized that yeah, we needed spin lock to further improve the performance. Accumulated both. So both are transfer occurs during both chirp pulse and spin lock.
Okay.
We never really quantified how much. Mm-hmm.
So this is really interesting. We see that the transfer is better if we have less power on the protons. Less power. So as you say, we must have a matching condition also during the spin lock now. But if I use 15 watts on the protons, let's just have a look. Was it bad for 15 watts means that I'm here. So I'm going back to my optimization of the spin lock power, the excitation pulse power on the protons. And 15, what do we choose? Do we choose 15? Do we choose something else? What's your opinion? So if we use 15, it means that we lose a few percents here, but we have a better transfer to carbon. Sorry? Yeah. But it means that when I will do the multi-CP, this shows me that when I do a CP, I will lose a bit more proton than I could, and then I need to recover more. But let's choose this. Okay, so we said that we would keep PLW21, the power on the 90 degree pulse of protons, to 15, that we would use the excitation pulse for the carbon 180 watts, and now we can optimize the spin lock power on the carbon on the same range. How am I with time? I was supposed to finish this exactly now. Just a little late, but not a lot. So now what do we expect on this one?
I would say up and down.
Yeah. We would like to see up and down. Sometimes we see only up because we don't have enough power. Yeah. And this is, for me, this is the most interesting part. This is this interplay. Okay, if I cannot reach the maximum, it means that I don't hit the Hartmann-Hahn condition. So I will want to decrease the power on the proton. But if I decrease the power on the proton too much, it means I will not sustain the proton. So if you have a super good probe with very high B1s, you don't care, but sometimes... It's not really relaxation, it's decoherence because your spin lock is not strong enough. And does not seem to be going down very much. I have intentionally chosen 20 watts on the spin lock of the proton because I wanted to see it fail and then improve. Because this is what happened all the time. And sometimes it's more rare, but you can have the opposite, that you have not enough power on the proton and too much on the carbon. It depends on how the probe is, its performance. So this means that even with 180 watts on the proton, on the carbon, we cannot reach the Hartmann-Hahn condition. So Hartmann-Hahn means it's we want the nutation of the spin lock on the proton to be at the same rate of the carbon so that they can talk to each other. So what we do here, we had the spin lock, PLW22, on the proton was 20 watts. Let's go to, let's be a bit extreme, put 5 watts. So if you don't remember the relation between B1 and power, the good thing is the relation between power and power is just linear. So like B1 and B1 is linear, power and power is linear. So we expect that if we have the Hartmann-Hahn condition for a pair of powers on proton, and if you decrease them, you're still in a Hartmann-Hahn condition, but you might not be in the conditions where you sustain them properly. So if they, now we expect them to go up and go down, and if they don't go down, we are a bit sad. Please pray your favorite saints. And it's going down. It's going down, but we will have a look what it means in terms of, if we go back to the PLW11 optimization of the proton, what it means to have only 5 watts. And you will see it's not a choice that we are happy to make.
Can you superimpose this optimization in the previous one to see which one is really going the highest?
Yeah, I only do that in the end because then the screen goes crazy. So it's quite clear. We were super far from the Hartmann-Hahn condition, apparently. And this even makes me think that most of the transformers occur during the chirp here. Just a guess. Could be wrong. So nice, we can have the Hartmann-Hahn condition, but we are only using only 5 watts on the proton. 5 watts is this pulse here. So it means that just the fact of doing the spin lock on the proton, you are already losing by decoherence. So what we can do now is, say, okay, here we have the maximum at around 100 watts. We are fine putting up to 150 watts, let's say, on carbon. So now this means an increase of 1.5. So I'm going to do an increase of 1.5 on the spin lock power. PLW2, which is the proton, I increase by 1.5. I go to 7.5 watts, and I repeat the same optimization. And we expect to see the maximum shifting by 1.5, so to 150. Once in a while, we should have a look at the helium. No one remembered, so. Oh, here, it's funny, we can see the CP. So it's the pressure in the VTI, we are bringing watts of power. And so with a it's 100 watts pulses during milliseconds every second. So it's watts of power. And we see it makes the temperature. So that would be a way to calibrate the helium. If you don't have a resistor in your coil, you could put a lot of power in your coil, in the NMR coil.
In the probe, which you know, and how much power you put.
Exactly. Which is not completely straightforward, because you need to know the resistance of at this temperature. So, of course, you can have it, but you just need to have buy something that you can trust or calibrate. So Hartmann-Hahn was right, apparently. I'm confused. Oh yeah, so this one was the one that with not a lot of power. With too much power on the proton, sorry. So let's move them a little bit. It doesn't really improve, I agree. We get to the same maximum, but we lose less on the protons. So it means that we are losing less for the next round of CP. So to my eye, it is a much, much better choice. So let's write down our final choice of parameters. We have 180, that's for the excitation pulse from the carbon, 150, which was found by top spin as a maximum for the spin lock, 15 on the excitation pulse for the proton, and 77.5 watts as a spin lock for the protons. We have optimized all the pulses. We can now optimize the length of the spin lock. So this is the pulse length 15. And I will go from 500 microsecond. It's not happy. Okay, yeah, no worries. So I go from 500 microseconds to 10 milliseconds. Sometimes to really see the dynamics, we go to 30 milliseconds, things like this. It's nice to see how it plateaus. I want to play a bit safe. It would be really bad to burn the coil now. What do we expect now? Go up and down, go only up. It's we are changing the length of the contact pulse between the proton and the carbon. What are?
I mean, I think it depends on the distance from the proton to the carbon. So yep. I think for sites that are closer, then you have shorter contact times. Sites that are longer, then.
So what you say is that the closer they are, the faster they should transfer.
Yeah, so the
transfer.
Closer they are, the contact time is the lowest, and the other
yep.
way around.
So we have this, but we have another thing to take into account is relaxation. So if relaxation is significant, then it should go up and down. And if relaxation is not significant, it should only go up. And that's the beauty of gating the microwaves. So you will see now I will repeat this experiment without gating the microwaves. So now it does not go down. And let's have a look at the pulse sequence. You don't see it, it's not written here, but after doing DNP doing 1 second, here we gate the microwave and wait 500 milliseconds. During these 500 milliseconds, the electron polarization goes from something like 50% to, at 1.6 Kelvin, it's 99.5%. And at 99.5%, the electrons, they stop doing flip-flops. So you don't have parametric relaxation. Now, if I repeat this experiment, but the delay after gating the microwave, instead of using this 500 milliseconds that is really more than enough to let the electrons relax, I only wait 100 microseconds. This is my favorite experiment. Look what happens. So now we are really switching on relaxation. It's going up for now. And now it's already decreasing. So by switching off relaxation with the gating, we are really giving us more time to transfer the polarization from the proton to the carbons. We don't lose on the protons, so it's the figure here. Here you see we're going to record this one now, a long time where let's look at this one first. We look at the polarization of the proton during the multi-CP experiment. It builds up, we transfer to carbon, so we lose some. Then it builds up again, transfer to carbon, and so on. And you see what happens on the carbon. When we is this with and without gating? No, I think this is negative and positive polarization. If you don't do gating, when you go up, when you do the CP, you go much slower down every time because the proton lose not only by giving to the carbon but also giving to the lattice. And now we can compare this with the previous one and see the great improvement, the virtue of stopping the microwaves.
And what you can see here is that without gating, you polarize 1 second. And with 1.5 seconds, and with gating, you polarize 1 second. Because during the 5 milliseconds of gating, you keep polarizing. So the if you want to be fair, you should decrease the blue line by a third to have a fair comparison, because the blue line polarizing 1.5 times.
Yeah.
So it's even worse than that.
Yeah. I did not think about this. Okay, so I think with that, do we want to see the gating optimization? It's not very long. So, final thing I can do, I will choose, we can choose, like, to be safe, 6 milliseconds for the contact time. And I will play with the D7, which is the time.
Seconds.
Yeah, this is seconds. Time between stopping the microwave and doing the CP. Can I put 0? No, I cannot put 0. So I will put 1 millisecond. Two hundred milliseconds. No. Yeah, put 1 second here. Sorry, I'm a bit. He's 50, so. Oh shit. 25. That's good. So we will repeat the same CP with all the same parameters, but the only thing we vary is how long we wait between gating the microwaves and doing the CP. And this will be a measurement of the T1 of the electron. Because the more we wait, the more we let the electrons relax, and the more we quench parametric relaxation. And you can really take this principle to a high level of sophistication to measure a lot of like EPR parameters. That's something we Sami showed in the gating paper, and we have done a lot more, but not published yet, and some of it on Tuesday night. And a very nice relaxation rate to measure is the T2 of carbon spins, because it is very sensitive to this and this only. And there's no, I mean, it's also, you measure over microseconds, so it's more precise in time as well. So that's a more fair comparison of with and without gating now. This is 100 microseconds, this was 250 milliseconds, and you see the T1 is on the order of 50 milliseconds. We always put a gating delay of 0.5 seconds. You see here that it could be shorter, it's just our habit. So, to be consistent from experiment to experiment, we keep it like this. With this, we are done optimizing the CP. And we can move to a multi-CP experiment. And it's the last thing we're going to do before taking a break, I think. I don't have a break on my schedule. 3:15. It's long.
The break at 3:15?
Yeah, but we can do it earlier and then we can stop earlier.
Yeah, I think it's good.
It might be nice if you have ideas or something you want to try. Some parameter you'd like to see varying or extra goals. Maybe if you have extra time, you could maybe do something. Mm.
So think about it. And I carry on, but really don't hesitate to interrupt me and say, oh, I want to see this. Then we will do it. So now the multi-CP experiment. Yeah.
I just wanted to see this build-up of electrons. Is it also like up and down, or is it like mono-exponential? Is it like, what is it called?
Stretched?
It's...
So this is not a perfectly clean measurement of the electron polarization.
There are
some hidden... It's not completely linear to the electron polarization. So if you can make it linear, but you need to make the experiment a little more complicated.
In any case, it's like squared, right? It's not...
It's 1 minus p squared. So there are ways, and the way I do it... should I show what I did earlier in the week? Or is
it's very exciting to see.
So,
good luck with explaining it.
You can record it.
No, because we want to keep it secret.
Everyone who listens. Right.
So this is the best way to do it is to measure a relaxation parameter of NMR. Varying temperature to start with. When you vary temperature, you vary the electron polarization. So in this case, I have measured the T2 of electron spins of carbon spins with a Han echo at different temperatures, and these are the curves that you see. These are decay curves of Han echo. Then I fit all of them. This is in. I have to run the code to be able to. Give me a second. I want to make the figure bigger, I need to run it. So for now, it's just a normal T2 measurement where what we do is 1 second of dNP, CP, to have a consistent carbon polarization, and then T2 measurement. It's fitting. Just wanted to have the figure bigger, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I don't. I'll tell you if I do. So here you see the different T2 measurements. This is in a logarithmic scale, so it's linear. And it's fitted with a mono-exponential. And you see, I don't understand why it is mono-exponential, because there's a distribution of distances between the carbon spins and the radical. Still, it is mono-exponential. Then what you do is you correlate the R2 that you have measured with 1 minus p square of the electron. P is the electron polarization that you know from Boltzmann's law at the various temperatures. And you see that there's a nice correlation between R2 and this 1 minus p square. Okay, the residues, they are not perfectly aligned. Not perfectly random, but it is. We'll say it's good enough. The relaxation at zero polarization is not due to the electron, it's due to probably couplings with the proton spins, most likely. And the rest is due to the electrons. This means if I am 1.6 Kelvin, I'm here, there's almost only relaxation due to the electrons. And now when it means, this curve means that whenever I measure R2 of the carbon spins, whatever I've done in my experiment, thanks to this calibration curve, I can find back the electron polarization that's that was during that moment of the measurement of the T2.
So in this case, you gate the microwave.
I gate before the CP,
right.
and then I don't switch on again. Yeah. Yeah.
Just sorry, maybe I missed the information. How do you get the value itself of 1 minus T squared?
I know the temperature.
Yeah.
I don't touch the electrons in the microwave, so the electron polarization is Boltzmann polarization, and I calculate by hyperbolic tangent of h bar omega over 2 kT.
Mm-hmm.
So it's simply Boltzmann law. Because I haven't touched the electrons with microwaves.
But you change the temperature, so the electron polarization changes.
Okay, so the polarization you get from the Boltzmann formula is proportional to 1 minus p squared.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's No. Sorry. Each of these points is measured at a different temperature.
Yeah.
For each temperature, I measure, I calculate the temperature, the polarization,
yes.
And then I calculate what 1 minus p, 1 minus value squared.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you see this strange behavior of the residues when you do a proton T1 row?
Even worse, but I think I use a very wrong formula. It's more complicated with a T1 row, and what is written in my thesis is probably garbage on the T1 row. Because there's the power of the spin lock that comes in, and I did not take this into account. So that this is something we should look into.
Yeah, because there's something in this residue.
Yeah.
There's some other relaxation mechanism which I do.
Yeah.
Methyl proton driven.
Yeah, something like this. So now this experiment that I'm doing is after the CP, I switch on the microwave during a. Oh no, sorry, this one. I switch on the microwave. And I vary the time between switching on and measuring the T2. Or I switch on during a time that is long enough, and I vary the time between switching off and measuring the T2. And this is what we get. So these are typical. Here's one example. I vary the time during which I saturate the electron. And each of these points is a measurement of the carbon T2. And with 1 minus p squared, my relation, I can get the polarization of the electron at that point. And finally, we did it So this is the final result. That's what we got on Monday or Tuesday night. Is we measured the T1 of the electron at the time for saturating the EPR line. So saturating the EPR line is the blue one, and T1 is the orange line, as a function of how we modulate the microwave. So it's normal that the T1 measurement does not depend on how you modulate the microwave. It seems rather reasonable. This is much more surprising to explain, because it means, Sami, maybe you want to explain. Because this is in contradiction with what he presented last week. So it's in thermal mixing conditions, we assume that in a few tens of microseconds, the EPR line is stabilized. What you see here is really not tens of microseconds, it's tens of milliseconds. And that if also in thermal mixing condition, you saturate here, it goes everywhere. What we see here is that if we help it by modulating, it goes faster. So this is really quite in disagreement with the thermomixing theory.
I agree. The blue line should be flat. The spectral spin diffusion should be faster than that. Should be fast enough that we don't see an effect of the modulation bandwidth. And here the effect of the modulation bandwidth and the saturation rate is huge. Like it's a factor 6. So this is a very strong argument in favor of the idea that the spectral spin diffusion is way slower than what is calculated in the literature,
mm-hmm.
which I don't think has ever been measured in our conditions. So that might well be the very first measure of spectral spin diffusion by this indirect method. And it's like what, 3 orders of magnitude different from the theoretical predictions.
Yeah.
So it's a big news.
Could it be nice to repeat it on another sample? Maybe it's you because it was not fully homogeneous.
So at the time of speaking, Andrea Capozzi is measuring the same thing using LOD-ESR.
I received the results 5 minutes ago.
I want to see because I see them. It's on a WhatsApp group.
I never been the same with LOD-ESR. Wow. And so it's like same 6.7 Tesla, 1.5 Kelvin.
Because we tried to do it at 5 and then you don't see it. The T-saturation is 5.
The saturation curve, you could not observe it.
It's fine.
There's just modulation.
Which radical?
You did.
Tempo.
Ah, so you did them.
Tempo as usual.
You did this at what?
5.
Without hair? Ah,
yeah,
the BFL.
Yeah.
Where is he now? You're always traveling from one to the other.
Is it at 6 point? Then it was in Denmark.
So we sent him yesterday our sample formulation so that we are exactly on the same page with the same field. Well, the field is a bit different, 6.7 and 7. It's super close now. We're in pretty similar conditions. So it's really nice.
So it depends on the sample formulation.
It should depend on the electron concentration. That's the next thing we want to do, is increase the radical concentration to see if we see a change in the spectral spin diffusion dynamics.
But you say with
piezo
you don't observe this.
But it was at
5 Tesla. So that
could be
small and
at
so
which temperature?
Yeah, 1.2.
When you decrease the field, it means that the G tensor, you know, the G tensor will make the field, the EPR line broader, so it makes the electrons further apart. So it means that spectral diffusion has it's a harder time spreading the effect. Could an increase of 30% explain all this? This is surprising, but maybe that's what we have to to figure out now, because. Yeah, exactly. Should we go back to our business after this detour? But so, just in conclusion, I think this is a very, at least funny way to measure EPR properties in our conditions without changing the hardware. We don't need any extra coil, you use only NMR detection and you can measure EPR properties. It's long and complicated because with LOD-ESR, what we measure in 30 minutes, you measure in a few minutes. But it doesn't seem to be too biased, so it's sort of clean. Well, it's nice to compare, at least. So now going back to our multi-CP, we have optimized our CP. Here I have just copied the experiment, changed the pulse program to multi-CP, which you see here. The only difference now is that we add a loop here. So it means we have a detection loop here, where we have a detection pulse acquisition, we wait half a minute and go back, loop here, and once in a while we go to the CP and then loop. So we have two loops, nested loops. Usually we choose 30 seconds here. I will keep it like this. And there's an important parameter to decide, is how often do you do your CP. From this slide, you see that you need to do a CP whenever your proton polarization is high enough, on the order of T1. And we have measured the T1, we haven't measured the T1 at 1 Kelvin, so let's have a look. Yeah, cDNP. So this is a little biased by radiation damping, as you can see. We don't need to be super precise. We just need to say, okay, here I'm fine. I will wait until at this point. But that's very long, 60. That will be a bit long, 60 times 5 seconds. That's
Your build up here is contaminated by the line narrowing, so you feel like, oh, it's still growing, but it's not growing. It's just that you lose less in the time.
Yeah.
So it could well be that here you're already at the plateau, and you want to be a bit...
We can also choose to use our usual parameters and not think too much. But anyway, we want to wait something like T1 or tDNP between the CPs. And if we wait 6 times 30 seconds, that's what we usually do, it's good enough. So I have put 30 seconds. And here, this number is acquisition between CP steps. It means that I'm acquiring the signal 6 times between each CP step. And the delay between acquisitions is 30 seconds. So I have 30 seconds times 6 times, 3 minutes. Last thing I want to change is the number of points that I will acquire, the total one. So I can put 30, for example. With 30, I have a 15-minute experiment. Do you have questions before I launch it?
Okay, my question is like, these samples, they contain the protons, you know, like attached by covalent bonds. But how about a sample that doesn't have any protons and you have just to do the polarization of the solvent?
Yeah, in fact, I'm going to launch it and then talk, because why not?
Yes.
it makes more sense.
So yeah, how about just like you use the solvent? The protons of the solution, and then you have to do that spin diffusion from the proton free ex nuclei in this given sample.
Yeah, so what it will change is this curve. So this is a P50, the contact time of the spin lock. Mm-hmm. If you are doing the CP not from protons attached to the molecule, but from protons from the solvent, the distances might be longer. It depends on the size of the geometry of the molecule, of course. But on average, the distance between the carbon spins and the proton might be longer. So the dipolar coupling is weaker, and so the transfer is slower. So you just have to increase your contact time.
And how much we can increase it without protons?
It depends very strongly on the geometry of the probe, how well it was soldered, and things like this. It's not a clear limit, and suddenly you will... So a very clear indication that is going wrong is that you're doing an experiment like this, and one peak goes up, one peak goes down, and it goes erratic, because once you have had arcing, everything can happen. So usually, as Sami said, once you have done that, it's like you have a neon light bulb in your polarizer, and you need to fill it with helium gas, empty it to get rid of the ionization. And you know, okay, I'm not going to go to this high power again. And here, luckily, the probe seems to be behaving quite well. We went up to 180 watts during 10 milliseconds and didn't see any arcing. This is our carbon signal. Oh, I did a super big mistake. I'm measuring with 90 degree pulses every 30 seconds. So we like to use 5-degree pulses, and I just want to calculate again the 9.5 is our 90-degree pulse. I'm doing my little math, 171 microseconds. Sorry, I don't explain all the details, it's not very interesting. We want a power of 0.463. No. This was wrong. Yeah. Okay. What I often sometimes do as well, here I did not do it, but a nice thing you can do is once you have done DNP and you, like here we have, DNP was occurring, so proton spins were polarized. If you launch your CP experiment without saturation in the beginning, it means that you can use the DNP that was already there. Sometimes it can save you time. For example, you put a new sample before you want to do the dissolution, you put your new sample and you need to let the polarizer go down in temperature. So you can start doing DNP while it's going down in temperature. You don't want to do CP while you are refilling because there's gas and then you can have arcing. But you can still polarize your proton spins. And then once you are ready with temperature, you start your CP and you're directly at like 50 or 80% of your final polarization. It's a convenient way to gain time. If you have a slow pump in particular. So now can you explain me what I'm seeing? What is happening? We have a signal that is raising. Where does it come from?